Well, you know, I'm right now. I'm just pretty much just on a topic of how natural it is to flow in the gifts of the Holy Ghost, and helping people to understand that it does it really doesn't take effort to flow in the Holy Ghost and the gifts of the Holy Ghost. It's the most natural thing that a person that's born of the Spirit should be able to do. Until you're born of the Spirit, then the moving of the Spirit is a total mystery. It's totally, you don't know what's happening, you don't know where it's coming from, you don't know how it's going down. You're born of the Spirit because it's the most natural thing that you and I should be doing, being led of the being of the Spirit, born of the Spirit, one with the Holy Ghost. My goodness, he that is joined to the Lord is one Spirit, and the Lord goes on and on, made us the temple of the Holy Ghost, filled us with the Holy Spirit, the Holy Ghost is with us and in us. I mean, it just goes on and on and on and on. He's baptized us in the glory of the Holy Ghost. I mean, my goodness, that's a lot of Holy Ghost. I mean, somebody saying, well, how do I flow with the Holy Ghost? You got Holy Ghost every coming and going. My goodness gracious. Born of the Spirit, living by the Spirit, walking in the Spirit, led by the Spirit, Holy Ghost in you, Holy Ghost alongside of you, baptized in the Holy Ghost. It doesn't end. It doesn't end. And somebody says, well, what's the problem? The problem is the things that we allow to go on in our lives that block the flow. And that's why I like to just spend time focusing, helping people focus on the things that block the flow of the Holy Ghost. Because once again, this is by nature. This is the natural moving in the things of the Spirit is by nature for us, by this divine nature, the most natural, responsive thing that you and I should be doing. Unfortunately, what we do is we allow wrong kinds of thinking, wrong kinds of behavior, wrong kind of activity go on in our life. So before I say this, let me just set the stage. Jesus purchased the church with his own blood and baptized it in the Holy Ghost and fire, and that is the church. Today, I was listening to a woman. How many of you watched me on Facebook or follow me on Facebook? You saw my post from Bartleman, okay? From Frank Bartleman. If it wasn't for Frank Bartleman, we would not have known what happened in those three years of great revival that began on April the 9th in 1906. And basically ended 3 years later, and for a number of things happened where we see men sliding into it, men doing their stuff, people imposing upon the people who touched heaven. See, here's a man of God touched heaven. And now people want to come along and tell, no, you can't do it that way, or I believe you should do this, I believe you just that. And it just ultimately, it messes everything up, okay? And ultimately what Azusa Street became a literal manifestation of the way that the body of Christ is supposed to function, the way the church is supposed to function, because it became collective. No one knew who was going to preach. It wasn't white, it wasn't black, it wasn't, you know, red or yellow. It was just like Brother So-and-so is going to preach. God's put the anointing upon him. We all witnessed this. It was a very unique and situation of a revival that no matter whether you're reading the Bible or whether you look in every generation in which a revival took place, you're going to see the same things being reproduced by the Holy Ghost if we're willing to do it His way. And this is the whole problem. We're not willing to do things God's way. We allow mixture to come into our life. We allow things to affect us. We allow wrong models to influence us. And we got to be willing to humble ourselves under the mighty hand of God and do it God's way. You know, it's like there's a lot of people running around with leprosy and people running around with mud in their eye. And what's wrong with you, man? Why didn't you go dip 7 times in the Jordan? Why didn't you go wash in the pool of Siloam, for heaven's sake? Then they came, they were touched. Look, they had the word of God, and they were touched by Jesus. But they're still walking around with leprosy, and they're still walking around with mud in their eye because they want to do it their own way. Look, God's already done everything He's going to do. He's already poured these things out. He's faithful concerning His word. He's saying, now do it. Meet me here. Do it my way. And so you saw my post today about Bartleman saying, What happened? Why did the heavenly anthem leave? And he was talking about what was going on in those meetings where everybody began to sing by the Spirit, where it was a flow of the Holy Ghost, where it was a Holy Ghost rapturous song that just, you know, people would sing for an hour, 2 hours. And he said, well, then all of a sudden somebody started moving in and said, now turn the hymn books to page 249. We're going to sing when we all get over yonder or whatever else, you know. And so the organization of men and the ideas of men begin to displace the flow of the Holy Ghost. Well, I was listening to, you know, a woman who was, she was actually recorded, I believe it was 1968 or 1969, She was actually in those meetings as a 10-year-old girl. She was deaf, but completely born, completely deaf, and she was healed in the meetings. And she was healed while they were caught away in singing. And that's just the way the flow of the Holy Ghost went. God, the Holy Ghost, was in charge. And when He's in charge, then what we read in the Bible begins to happen. When people are submitted to these things, when they want to go all the way with God. So we understand Jesus purchased church with His own blood, baptized in the Holy Ghost and fire, and His church hasn't changed. And in the midst of His church, what did He do? The Scripture says He put apostles, prophets, evangelists, pastors, and teachers. A big part of that is people want to have their own apostles, own prophets, own evangelists, own teachers. They want to dub who they think is the right one, and they want to dub who they think is the wrong one. They want to be pick and choose. They want to critique it. They want to throw in their two cents. They don't believe in the sovereign, moving, capable power of God the Holy Ghost to do things through people He anoints. They want to make everybody Saul and very few Davids, you know. I mean, come on, you know. They want to make, there's very few Elijahs and a whole bunch of the, you know, the false prophets. Nonsense. Listen, we have to trust God, because one of the first fundamental attributes of God's divine love is trust. And what happens is people literally give place to and nurture fear in their life. Fear that produces distrust, fear that produces all kinds of criticism, all kinds of things that are divisive. So reality of it is, much of the church has never really moved into discernment of seeing a now God. They don't. They're babes, carnal, saying, I'm of this one, I'm of that one, I like this, I don't like that. Or they're babes being tossed to and fro by every wind of doctrine. They never really mature. The almost the best you can find in many places in Christianity are people who have great confidence and thanksgiving in what God did in the past and what He did in the future. And they can stand around and they can thank God all day. Oh, Father, thank You so much for all these things You did since, you know, Abel up to the present. Very few people grow and mature in God where that they'll be able to step into recognizing what God's doing right now. And become so overwhelmed and so thankful where they are elated, caught away by what God is doing now. Because God is doing so much now that if you begin to recognize it, we wouldn't be able to hold you in your seat. In fact, you through that thanksgiving and praise and recognition of what God is doing, you would be hooking up with what God is doing and thus be right over on the cutting edge. And I'm telling you right now, if there's anything I'm desperate to see a greater growth and maturity in my own life in, it is that. I'm going to practice that. I'm going to give myself to that. There is going to be a consecration. There's going to be a commitment. People that act like God's going to come down and jerk their will around. You're going to live as a, you're going to be an altar, a living sacrifice. It's you and I are going to say, listen, take my will and make it thine. It shall be no longer mine. That's just not a nice little song that we sing and feel a little bit better about this situation because pastor's not screaming at us. Are you with me? Okay. But actually, the impact of it is more dramatic. What you're putting on you, huh? What you're committing to do is far more dramatic. Really, all of my shouts, all of my preaching is all about getting people into a realm of being blessed. That's it. I'm just trying to run off the wolf that you're petting. I'm just trying to cut the snake head, the head of that snake off that you seem to have made a pet out of. I mean, I'm just very, very sensitive to the things that people allow in their life that's keeping them from doing what God says to do, because I'm into the glorious church. I love the church. I love Jesus. I want to participate with what Father's doing, and He's dedicated to glorifying His Son. And I recognize where people allow a bunch of stuff in their life that shuts down the flow of the Holy Ghost, and I'm not going to stand for it. Listen, reality of it is, look at my life. Just look at my life. And then go back and look at everybody's life who God put it in their life. I guess we were born with it for the purpose of seeing His will, His revivals, His moving of His Spirit in His church take place. We are just born with His cause. And we scream and holler about it until it busts forth. Just go look. I don't care where you look in history. Go look. There's people that, and I'm not going to stop until everybody understands this is what we're going to have to do. This is what God has purposed for us to do if we're going to step over in these realms of glory. Huh? No revival took place like a prairie fire. Never. Never. It was sowed into. It was developed. If people laid down their lives for it. You listen to me. Jesus will never be revealed in your life until you lay down your life. And that's going to come to the place where you're upholding your own honor, your own identity, your own personality, your own things. This is just the way it is, people. He's not mixing it up in the self realm. We have a hard time with the simplest challenges from God. Are you listening to me? And how much more on even a larger scale then is the impact when we're supposed to become part of a living church, when we have a problem with authority. When you got a problem with authority, you can't become a part of a living church. Because God placed authority. What is authority? That's the person in charge. Apostle, prophet, evangelist, pastor, and teacher. With not just gifts and talents that are natural that you can compete up against. It is completely out of the range of human ability. It's a divine ability that God has given. And now we're going to sit around and we're going to criticize that. You're criticizing God, the Holy Ghost. You think you're going to grieve Him? You think you're going to violate things in the Spirit? And it's going to be okay for you? It's not going to be okay for you. And what God, in His mercy, provides a means for us to repent and get forgiven. But a lot of people don't repent because they self-justify. I mean, the Lord comes, brings us in the light to show us what's hindering us from a greater flow. The greater flow is already here. It's the most natural thing you can do. The big issue here is there's these hindrances, there's these wrong ideas, these wrong opinions, this wrong thinking, these things that we've convinced ourselves of that are easily corrected only if we would just sit down and read the Bible and say, I'm going to now let God's word rule over me. I'm going to do it God's way. Huh? People say, oh, I would have loved to have been in those meetings. Maybe not. Maybe not. They were three times a day, seven days a week for 3 years. Maybe not. And that was preceded by meetings that had been going on the same length of time at the Baptist church under Smalley, and who was touched by the Wells revival. Huh? They went on for almost 4 years, 3 years. They went on for 3 years too. And then those merged into what took place. And then if there was anything whatsoever, Pop Seymour would be up there on the platform. And if there was anything that he felt was out of order, he'd start going. He'd stomp his feet. And everybody would start recognizing, Pop Seymour's got problems. He'd just stomp his feet. And the place would come hush. And if it didn't get corrected then he'd come up behind him. And he'd start ministering to him and say, listen, that ain't God the Holy Ghost. Stop. Why? We want to keep the flow. We don't want God the Holy Ghost to get grieved with another thing from another human being. This is God's house. We're coming under His flow and His glory. People say they'd stand out on the outside. Even when it was started, the meeting first started in the house and there was just a few people there. I mean, they would stand on the outside and be shaken by the power of God because there were some people who had totally given themselves over to say, I don't want any of me no more. We're desperate for you, God. Spiritual hunger is where you want to be what He's purposed you to be, and you won't live without it. You want to do what He's purposed you to do, and you won't live without it. You want to have what He's purposed for you to have, and you won't live without it. You see? Dear people, if we can begin to learn how to speak as God has given us the ability to speak by revelation, hallelujah. Thank God for prophets, tongues, interpretation, tongues, being able to speak by doctrine, by revelation, by the Spirit. And we say, wait a minute, you know what? This is supposed to be in every part of my life, and I'm going to categorize everything else as either jesting, foolish talking, or vile talking, or meaningless talking, or something like that, because that's pretty much synonymous with vain talking or foolish talking. We do a lot of that, and we're not sowing into the right thing there, huh? It's better for us to just keep our mouth shut. The great preacher Campbell went and visited the great, great orator and preacher, evangelist, pastor Campbell went and visited Evan Roberts one day. And Evan Roberts came down from his room and Reverend Campbell said, as soon as he did, Jesus was walking in the room. He lived a life of prayer. He didn't pray 4 or 5 hours a day. He prayed 10, 11, 12 hours a day. That's all he did, just pray. Just shut in with God, praying for revival and the move of the Spirit. And I'm telling you right now, great things happen through that. You spend a life of prayer. Somebody said, prayer, you need to get up, start moving. I'm telling you right now, there's some people who can change nations through prayer. Okay? I mean, when you begin to understand the reality of the power of prayer, where we literally get to take someone and bring them in the before the throne of God to where that they cannot live as they have lived anymore. They are no longer cloaked or absent from being right front and center. And I take somebody and I can bring them front and center to the presence and the purposes of God through prayer. And nations, and I mean, come on, you know. Some people have got a hold of that faith, and I understand. It's not just some head knowledge, it's a heart knowledge, it's faith. God shakes us with the reality of these things that he's given to us, and then they begin to become activated with power in our life, heavenly power, God power. You know, and that's what he's given us. He's given us God, his life, his power, his divine ability. Hallelujah. Thank you, Father, for that. And that's with the life and ministry of Jesus, anointed with power and with the Holy Ghost. That's us. No, we don't have to concern ourselves about talking to God and anointing us with power and the Holy Ghost. We've got to be concerned about the things that we would allow in our lives that would hinder the flow, that we would commune with, that are just going to put upon us doubt and unbelief, which also comes really out of the realm of fear. Because I'm telling you right now, when you're walking over here in this love and being motivated and moved by this love, goodness, faith is just explosive continually. But the Lord put in the church, apostles, prophets, evangelists, pastors, and teachers. We need to recognize them for what they are. We need to treasure them. First of all, we need to treasure the church for what it is, the manifest person of Jesus Christ. It is the fullness of him that filleth all things. We've got to recognize that there's that level of honor and sacredness that must be in the place. It goes beyond what grandpapa's, granddad's sacredness and honor was in the church, where they make sure that they would remove their hats and they would bow their heads and they behave themselves in certain ways because this is Father's house. It goes beyond all of that. He says, well, the Holy Ghost wants to be completely and totally in charge in here, and it's easily, he is easily refused. He's easily grieved. He's easily rebuffed. He's easily resisted, and we want to learn how not to do that. And that's going to be a big part of how we live out our everyday life, because you can't turn the switch on and off, okay? You can't suddenly turn on the switch of the Spirit and begin to flow, because all the stuff you've been given to all week long is going to harass your mind the whole time. And all that's going to be is a deliverance meeting. Praise God for deliverance. We have the power and authority to cast out devils, to bind evil spirits. But the bottom line of it is, dear people, God's not going to do something against your will. And when you look at revivals like that, like that took place in 1906, that is a revival. That's, first of all, the church's hearts were being turned back to God. Out of that came a revival. Out of that came an awakening. Huh? It surely did. Throughout the nations of the earth. When you look at that, that didn't start with a bunch of people just satisfied being religious. Well, I go to church here because all my friends go to church here. And I don't care what the pastor says. I don't agree with him and everything he says anyways. All dishonoring and grieving the Holy Ghost, reproving and rebuking God. It's really what it comes down to. These are all a bunch of hungry people, so desperate for God. They're so sick and tired of the pabulum of religion. That's what God gathered around. Huh? It's true. You know, it brings me to tears when I think about Pop Seymour. Because of segregation in Topeka, Kansas, he couldn't go in and sit in the meeting. He had to sit on the stairs outside, broken down stairs outside, and listen. They were at least willing to crack the door so he could hear in. Bless his heart. And then when it came time for tearing, because they believe you were supposed to tarry for the Holy Ghost, he had to get down on his knees in the dirt outside because he still wasn't allowed to go to the altar. Because why? Because men and women of God were so influenced by their culture, they were deceived by their culture. How much are we deceived by our culture and influenced by the surroundings that, right now? Things that we're willing to accommodate, things that we're willing to sell out for, things that we're willing to compromise with. I mean, it brings me to tears when I start thinking about it. But man, what God did through him, because here's desperate, hungry people. Then he gets an invitation to come out and preach at the Nazarene Church in Los Angeles. He gets there one night. He hasn't even had the experience yet, but he opens up the Bible and says that there's a baptism in the Holy Ghost, and that this baptism in the Holy Ghost is witnessed and revealed only by the evidence of the language called tongues. And they threw him out. And they've been throwing the Holy Ghost out ever since. And so there's a lot of other churches. And I can show you other things that happen. We can look. For one of the things that I love to do, what God has caused me to do, to be a part of what my life is about, is seeing where people stop the move of God. I don't want to reproduce that. I want to see that in my own life. Is that going on in my life? There were certain actions recorded that stopped the move of God. It's not that God's not moving. It's that we've now created a barrier and a hindrance of that flow. We substituted him for something else. We've allowed other beliefs, other things. God is not going to do anything outside of His Word. He's the Spirit of truth, and the Word of truth is it. And you and I got to be willing to be conformed to it. We're going to have to be willing to bow to it. We're going to have to be willing to come to a revelation that He's willing to give and be in awe of His holy presence. He is a holy God. Let the earth tremble. True. And then, you know, it goes on to say what He's placed within His church. After we look at the fact that His church is Him, it's the manifestation of His person. It's the fullness of God. When we begin to approach the things of God with due order and with right judgment and with a right heart. Because I'm telling you right now, people say, well, God knows my heart. Well, I tell you what, we know your heart too. Your actions describe and display what your heart is. And if we want to move in these things that are supposed to be so natural, because they are so natural, which exist and dwell right now, we're going to have to be willing to recognize who God is and give Him the due reverence and give Him the due honor and the due submission and the due servitude. Because these things, if we would begin to willing to do this, if it just this number of people in this place here tonight would begin to allow God to search their heart instead of self-justify, begin to search their heart and begin to repent and begin to humble themselves before God in the areas that we are not giving Him His honor, His glory, His reverence. We are not recognizing the courts on whom that we tread, the place that we are now walking, the place that we now find ourselves existing. I mean, we begin to move this way, I'll tell you right now, with consecration and commitment to do it God's way, it turned the world upside down. God doesn't take many. It doesn't take many. This is the street people. Were people who were tired of religion. They didn't have hurts and offenses. They wanted God. They just were tired of religion. They're tired of living without the power and the glory of God that is described in as the will of God in His Word. They were tired of being part of a church that didn't look anything like the church described in the Word. And most of them were ministers. Most of them were preachers. Methodist preachers, Baptist preachers. Leaders of the church, and then what? That were hungry, desperate, tired of it all, kicked out, refused, discouraged, disappointed with everything that was going down, had to have God, couldn't live another day without Him, saying, God, you've got to do something because I can't go on like I am now. And then what was added to that was just the unbelievers coming right, left, and center. And so they were born into a move of God with the right model. You see what I'm saying? They were born into God, in the move of God, with the right heart and with the right spirit. When a bunch of back talking going on, finger pointing, lies and accusation, constantly running down the men of God. Anybody who's anointed, they're gonna immediately start getting all of that. It's gonna come from every direction. And that's one of the biggest things that we fight. We fight that. That's the battle that we fight. We understand that Satan is opposed to the anointing. The world will destroy the anointing. The demonic will destroy the anointing. And so we understand how to protect the anointing, how to just keep ourselves in the love of God, move with God. And as we grow and mature, we begin to understand how to help protect the move of God, as it were, by making sure that we keep our hearts right. But the next dimension of this, of that representation of that mouthpiece ministry of apostles, prophets, evangelists, pastors, and teachers that is given for your perfection, you're not going to have it without Him. So you better get real happy. And you better understand how to honor that. Because if you don't honor it, you can't receive from it. Go read the Bible again. Go read what Jesus said. If you can't honor it, you can't receive from it. If you don't recognize the gifting, you can't receive from the gifting. The Lord Jesus preached a sermon on it. The prophets preached a sermon on it in the Old Testament. You're not going to receive from it. And so people say, well, I'm walking with God. I'm just doing it on my own. You know, I'm just connected with the body of Christ globally. That's nonsense. You need to be under authority, man. What are you, an apostle, prophet, evangelist, pastor, teacher, all wrapped up in one? Maybe you, Jesus, and the Holy Ghost, too. It's nonsense. God's put His house in order, and people better understand. You're not going to come to God unless you seek Him by due order. Not in the Old Testament, not in the New Testament. Father's not going to have any mixture of that which He demands with anything that men dream up and believe. We just have to fall down and repent. It's easy to move forward with God. When the word of correction comes forth, don't self-justify. You can either have self-righteousness or His righteousness. His righteousness is an obedience to His Word, a submission to His Word. That's it. Say, God, take over. I'm going to do it your way, whatever you want. That's His righteousness. Self-righteousness is where you're always trying to burn up an interference or protection. Well, I don't believe that. I don't agree with that. I don't. What do you believe? What do you agree with? because I'm going to tell you right now, I don't care if it's a Jesuit priest or some Episcopalian preacher or some, you know, sold out Pentecostal preacher. Everybody's going to say with one voice, if everybody would read the Word of God, the Bible, as it is written, we would all have the same conclusion. We would all believe things exactly the same because it's written for what it is. You can't, I mean, you can go some different directions with the book of Revelation, but by and large, the majority of everything that's said is said in such simple ways, it's impossible to misinterpret. Love your enemies. Bless them to do that despitefully use you. And the like. Because that's the way the Lord brings it down. The Lord tells me how to walk in humility and submission. As long as I do it, it will keep me right, no matter how stupid I am. No matter how much lack of revelation and insight I have about God. And furthermore, it will then ultimately bring me to revelation and insight in God through obedience. Because I'm telling you, that's the way it comes. The anointing, increase in anointing is directly proportional to the consecration. It is. It's witnessed in the Word of God and by every move of God that's ever taken place. It is. I'm telling you, miraculous change and revelation is connected with obedience to the Word. The more you obey, the more you see. Amen. He says, I want to see first. No, you obey first. Then we come down to looking at and all that the Lord has for us, and the manifestation of the Spirit is given to every man. And you'll hear me talk about these things all the time. And you know, every time I pray, you're going to hear me thanking the Lord for it. I'm not saying, oh God, please. I'm thanking Him because it's a reality in my life. These sometimes in a meeting, there'll be every manifestation of the gifts of the Spirit that I've ever read about happening. At some degree, not at the matured level that I want them to be, not at the matured level that Christ Jesus wants them to be. He wants them to be at the mature level that He expressed them and even greater. And I'm going to tell you right now, they're just sitting around waiting for that day to happen. It ain't going to come. It's moving in what you know and have in God right now and wringing it out to every drop till the thing is dry and crying out to God for more, like a thirsty man who has no water. Obeying God, believing with God. I'm believing God and moving with God. It isn't sitting around just praying, oh God, agonizing. Oh Lord, what is it going to take? It's rather having a prayer and a conversation of thanksgiving and praise and talking about all of His mighty acts and His wonderful works and thanking Him for all that He is doing. Hallelujah. And recognizing the revelation of His glory that exists right here with me right now. That'll get you into the mood of God quicker than anything. I've never had the manifest presence of God talking about my failures, my shortcomings, the things I thought I should have done, didn't do, and asking this and asking that, and the problematic issues, huh? No. Always in the midst of thanksgiving and praise and consecrating, Father, I'm going all the way with You. Hallelujah. You've given me the capacity. I'm going to be that which You describe. These works are greater works. I thank You, Father, for the greater works being manifested through my life. Come on. Yeah. Doesn't matter who you are, huh? I mean, people have done so much in human faith. What happens when you wake up with divine faith? And the stories go on, I mean, on and on and on. I mean, a little guy comes from the Midwest and can't even stand up in the whitewater and says, I'm going to go and I'm going to win the Pipeline Masters. And everybody looks at him like, you're nuts. No, they didn't understand how disciplined he was and how focused he was, and he won the Pipeline Masters. He beat people surfing who'd been surfing since they were born, practically. And he just started 2 years previously. They didn't know the passion that was in this kid. Huh? That's just human faith. That's human passion. And I could go on and on and on with situations of athletic events and athletic feats and financial and economic and political. Come on, how about we hook up with the power of the living God for the kingdom of God? Amen, I'm telling you right now, there is no limits. God said no limits. And this is born and it's developed and it's matured in the local church. It's the authority of the local church. And what happens if Satan's got good strategy? He says, okay, I'm going to go in there and I'm going to tweak the local church because I can shut the whole thing down by and large by tweaking the local church. I'm going to go in and I'm going to sow discord. I'm going to be a lion spirit in their mouth. I'm going to be a lion spirit in their head. I'm going to create all this upheaval because then I can stop the flow. Because fundamentally, it's this wonderful dimension of coming together and being in agreement, having the same purpose, the same heart. Every move of God that you've ever seen take place, there is that element there. It doesn't matter. And all, that's why most move of God start, that change the world, start with a small group of people, because it's really difficult to get a large group of people all agreeing about anything. Even Jesus. Even the Holy Ghost. even heaven. And especially the manifestation of the Spirit. Oh, my goodness. You got to be willing to let the chips fall where they may. Let the fire burn where it will. And say, it's going to be this way, and it's not going to be any other way. And if you want another way, go start your own rebellious church. Or go join one that's already in existence. And if you can show me where what I'm saying is not God's will in His Word, then I'll be the first one to go to the altar and repent. First to God, then second to you. And then back to God again. Are you listening to me? Because you got a Bible you can read. God the Holy Ghost will stir you up with the same zeal that Christ Jesus has for His house. You tell me Jesus didn't have zeal for His house? The Scripture says that the zeal of the house of the Lord has consumed Him. Huh? It's the only thing that Jesus ever displayed a great anger to where His... When the Scripture says God is angry, it literally says this, His nose flared up. And we translate that anger. Flared up nose. That's a direct translation from the Hebrew language. That's mad. You know anything that we see Jesus upset about? People not honoring and respecting and reverencing the house of the Lord. The sacredness of it. Ha ha. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. That's why I know that the temple wasn't abandoned in Jesus' days. I don't care what people say about the third, the Ark of the Covenant or this or that. And the other. No, it was His glorious house at that moment in time. Jesus said so. Huh? So it's His glorious house even in a greater way right now. But you know what? Here's what happens. Whatever we really live, what really is in us is going to come out, especially in His house. And if we don't hold that His house, our lives, is His house and it is sacred, and we don't live in that sacred realm, then we're going to defile everything that is sacred. We're going to treat His house just like we treat His house. You listen to me. And then we need to understand, He's taken over, He's moved in. I don't have any rights anymore. And I'm happy about that. He owns me. I'm His purchased possession. Praise God. Hallelujah. I don't want it any other way. I'm written in the book of those who belong to Him. And so He says, and He makes it so natural. He makes it so ordinary. He makes it so common. Huh? It's like, James Levesque was with me, and we were out playing golf, and there's rabbits jumping everywhere. And he's going, look at these rabbits everywhere. And we're just like going, what? And he's like, oh, quit acting like this is normal. No, it is, man. There's rabbits everywhere around here. This is normal. And then we really had the same kind of response to the Holy Ghost. Oh, no, man, somebody's speaking in tongues. Yeah. Well, quit acting like this is normal. This is some supernatural event. At Azusa Street it was. It isn't now. So most people have moved past the great controversy. It split churches. It split families. Even to this day, it's a subject of great controversy. But hey, listen, there's an explosive growth in God that is being experienced by the church. There's events right here, right now, in 2015. Right now. Right this day, right now. There's happening in the realms of God. And whoever is willing to submit to His realm and shut out everything, all the other stuff, is going to step right into it. Let me just say this before I start continuing to read the list of what exists naturally in the church and what you then get developed by your connection with the church, because this is the way it happens. I'm going to tell you right now, I know Jesus Christ, by succession, has personally laid hands on me. And you as well, if you've been born again, I guarantee you. Because the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ spread like that. Peter went laying hands on everybody. Paul went laying hands on everybody. The people they laid their hands on went laying hands on everybody. And it just grew until today. Hallelujah. Praise God. You know, I've been personally touched by Jesus in that way, you know. In succession. So are you. There's something far greater going on, though. It's the living presence of the Holy Ghost. Jesus said, it's more expedient for you that I get out of here, that I go away. How can that even be possible? Because God the Holy Ghost is going to come. People, you know, I was just dealing with a minister earlier today on this subject, and I classified this. So I say minister earlier today, because I want to set the bar. I know that even ministers, Holy Ghost ministers, have problems with this. How much more do I know that everybody sitting in this place have problems with this? To where that they do not know how to touch heaven on a level to where it's like water busts forth from you. Okay? Listen, if you've ever worked around any big dams, it's scary. Even small dams. Because when a dam breaches, you're going to get washed away. You ain't going to fix that thing. When the water busts forth, it's in control. It's in control. I'm not talking about damming up a little mud hole. Okay? I'm talking about where there's a lot of water. Okay? There is a place in God where you can come and live in where every day that glorious breaking forth of God would be like that water breaking forth from a dam. You're gone in that, well, not only with tongues, but also with the understanding also. Now, why is that so important? Because that that release of God the Holy Ghost, literally, the best way to describe it, I don't know that this is literal, but the best way to describe it is anything that would be affixing itself to you, sickness, disease, virus, offense, problems, discouragement, whatever, broken, right there, broken, it's just broken. That flood, you don't have to say anything about those situations, just that flood of divine power of God releasing forth from us. This is what a scripture means when he's saying be filled with the Spirit. Admonish one another, speaking to one another in these things of the Spirit. It's why we need to get rid of foolish and jesting and idle talking that goes on that is meaningless and so made up so many people's conversation. It's time to learn how to speak out of the realms of heaven, because that's where these things of heaven are activated. That's where you and I begin to benefit, and all the stuff that would come and attach and affix itself to us is broken. And then in that place, when we begin to talk to others, that same thing is broken. Amen. Same thing is broken. There's been times that, you know, I've been interacting with people and I see them in that ditch. I see them in a place of discouragement. I see them in a place of doubt and unbelief. I see them in a place of being overwhelmed. What does Scripture say to you when you're overwhelmed? Huh? Go to the rock that's higher than you. Huh? That's not a religious activity. That's the thing of the Spirit that's available to us. And then I recognize that what's going on. I recognize something oppressive, and I'll start speaking loud. So what's wrong with you? Why is it that you're stuck in doubt and unbelief? And now people want to run, hide in shame, get upset, huh? Saying, you're hollering at me. I'm breaking off that stronghold off you right now. And I've watched it repeat over and over and hundreds upon hundreds of times in people's lives. I watch it happen in the church. People are going to get mad, sad, or glad about it. Happens that way every time. And it's usually just either glad or mad. Sad's usually not even around. You know what I'm saying? Huh? You know the definition of sad, right? Here's everything that God says, but unwilling to do it and turns away sad. That's the rich man, right? Mad, just religious. Huh? Glad is, yeah, I'm taking this. It's usually not the integrity of the rich man. This suddenly stands there and an honest heart says, am I really willing to turn all my stuff over to God, to have him, follow him? And goes, no, I'm not willing to do that. And goes away sad. Huh? There's a lot of integrity there. It's poorly directed. But it's at least it's honest. That's why I say we don't have a lot of sad. Mostly mad and glad. And I just want everybody to get glad. I want you to understand that there's a realm of prayer, and it is a realm of thanksgiving and praising him. And as you begin to praise him and give thanks, all the things that are written in the word are written so that we might know that he's doing it right now too. What he did then, he's doing it right now. It's supposed to give us faith. Hallelujah. It's supposed to cause us great confidence. Hallelujah. Yeah. And I pray that begins to happen in your life. And because as you do that and you step into that, that's why we really, you know, after the Lord gave me this word, command you to go through the Bible in 90 days or as close to it as you possibly could, set a threshold for yourself. The Lord said to me, made it very clear to me, they need to learn how to, a culture of standing before my presence. And so that's what I'm saying. You need to get into this thing. You need to learn, come touch heaven. The other night I was saying, the Spirit of the Lord is saying, take hold of it now. Lay hold now. Lay hold of these things of God. And I watched as the people who are more mature to responding to the Holy Ghost, more yield to the Holy Ghost, I watched it began to be activated. The gifts of the Spirit were here. There were things hindering, blocking, attitudes, all have to do with self stuff. Some of it's demon stuff. just blocking, just I got this thing to do or that thing to do, or I'm hurt about this, or I'm distracted about that, or discouraged about this, or overwhelmed about that. You're going to have to understand that that's going to get worse until you come over here. And if Jesus Christ comes by you and says, stand on one foot and lift up your left hand and with a peace sign and stick your tongue out, you should get up and do it. You know what I'm saying? If he says, because the Holy Ghost says, I want you to start blowing spit bubbles right now. Right? You want me to show you what I mean? No, I just did. Huh? Then you should just start doing it. Reckon?
Yeah.
So what if his servant does? What if his servant says, go dip seven times in Jordan right now? What can you do? I don't have to do that. I don't feel like it. And I only do what the Holy Ghost makes me feel. No, the Holy Ghost is going to make you feel as soon as you obey. It's going to, and the miracle is going to happen as soon as you obey. Are you listening to me?
Yes.
Oh, I'm not doing that. I don't do that. That's exactly the way you live in your life, and it's keeping you from all the good things of God. And I'm not going to sit back and watch you do continual damage to yourself and hinder yourself from all the blessings that you so desperately want and that Jesus died at Calvary for you to have. Huh? Excuse me while I do everything possible to get you blessed. Excuse me while I run off that thing that's about to destroy you. Huh? You'd be thanking me right, left, and center if it was a mountain lion creeping up behind you and pew, I took it out and you're like, I was about to be eaten. You saved my life. I mean, what can I do? What can I do to really show my appreciation? I owe my life to you. I was about to be taken out. Exactly. The Lord is our shepherd. He's taking good care of us. I'd rather be a sheep with a shepherd than a lion or a bear any day. Amen.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. The Lord gave me that revelation about 4 weeks ago. It's a simple revelation, but it's beautiful. Well, I was preaching it, and I was just, you know, I was thinking, I was contemplating. I hadn't said it because I was a minister. I was just contemplating some things in my spirit, thinking about them, about the lion, the tribe of Judah, and his servants running with faces like a lion. And all of a sudden, I heard the Spirit say, it's better to be a sheep with a shepherd than a lion or a bear. Come on, man. I'm like, Jesus, you're my shepherd, Lord. Who can defeat you? I'll be your sheep. I don't want to be no lion. Oh, God, I want to be your sheep. Come on. I love revelation. I love hearing him whisper. I love hearing him thunder. I love the movings of the stillness of the Spirit. I love the rushing, roaring, mighty waves of the Holy Ghost. I love it all. Man, I'm in for the move. I'm in for the moving of the Spirit. I love heaven. I love everything that heaven conveys. What God the Holy Ghost is doing is heaven. He's conveying heaven. I want heaven. I don't want to just die and go to heaven. I want to live in heaven right now. God has purposed for us to have days of heaven upon the earth. Jesus defines heaven. He is heaven. Heaven is Jesus and Jesus is mine. So I'm living in heaven today. A.B. Simpson. His true words. The Lord shows us so how natural the flow is. He says, therefore, in verse 11, I mean, forgive me, verse chapter 12, verse 7, he says, I'll find here in a minute. He says, but the manifestation of the Spirit is given to everybody. It's just natural. It's just there. It's yours. Huh? Hallelujah. Come on, I say it. And, of course, the context is everybody that's baptized in the Holy Ghost. Because that's where the flow comes forth from. That's the overflow of it. And then he just describes what it is. And these things, they're right here. They're for us right now. It isn't the issue of the availability and the supply. It's the issue of the things that we allow in our spirit and our thinking that blocks it and hinders it. Everything from fear and self-consciousness. I love to talk to people on this level. Listen, if you can just learn how to praise God in a public place as though you were all alone with him. Because everything else disappears in that place, huh? I mean, Catherine, it was so real to me when I first heard Catherine Kuhlman after she was dead and after this had become a reality to my life. I heard her say that she had a vision of how it was that we were going to have an audience with Jesus when there was such an innumerable company of people. And she said, immediately when you get caught away in that place where you're alone with him, you're immediately front and center, face to face, and all the crowds behind you. And I said, yeah, that's it. That's exactly what I've been experiencing in the Holy Ghost. where I don't even see anybody anymore. For me, that is absolutely a necessity before I open my mouth and begin to share with you the Word of God, begin to minister to you on any level here in this place, where I'm alone with Jesus in a public place. Where that is something that gets nurtured, not in church only, though I may hook up with it. Yes, because the supply of that is here, because God placed it in the midst of His church so that we can now have this multiplied to us. We can hook up with it, we can receive, we can have it modeled for us. But then it's supposed to be something that we go on to know the Lord in every day, where we say, this is so beautiful, I don't just want to wait. If I thought I had to wait the next Sunday, I'm just going to stay in the building. If that glory, if that anointing that is in the meetings here in this place, every time that we meet, whether anybody else is in it or not, I'm in it. And if I thought that this glory could only be realized here in this place, I would never leave. But I get to take it home with me. I came with it. I'm going to leave with it. I'm going to live in it. The glory of fellowship and communion is standing before His presence. People, when you're aware, when we're aware that He is before us and at our right hand, that we should not be moved. I'm going to tell you right now, temptation takes on a whole other different dimension. Huh? Because you look at Him and you look at that and you go, I'm going with You, Father. I want to please You, Father. Huh? It doesn't mean that temptation isn't just as strong as it is for everybody else. I have a greater influence on my life. So I'm not a forgetful here. I'm not having any temporary insanity in the fullness of the word. You know what I'm saying? Mama's a complete, don't remember who I am. I mean, it's like a disease, spiritual disease, Alzheimer's, spiritual Alzheimer's, a complete forgetting of who you are, and you recognize no one. Jesus, help us. We rebuke that in Jesus' name. We command it to go. And so he tells us the power gifts, the revelatory gifts. I line them up a little bit different than what they're lined up here, but the spirit of wisdom and spirit of knowledge, the word of knowledge, the word of wisdom, the word of knowledge, the gift of faith and the gifts of healing and the working of miracles and prophecy and discerning of spirits and diverse kinds of tongues and interpretation of tongues. I line them up like this. I line them up like I say, thank You, Lord. And you hear me say this over and again. I line them up with first and foremost the revelatory gifts, the word of knowledge, the word of wisdom. Thank You, Lord, for the word of knowledge, the word of wisdom, and for the discerning of spirits. Those are the revelatory gifts. That's not all of them, but those are three that are highlighted right there. And then I say, I thank God for the power gifts. Thank You, Father, for the working of miracles, the gifts of healing, and the gift of faith. Power gifts. Then I thank God for the vocal gifts. It's not all of them, but it's highlighted three. And then I thank God for the vocal gifts, you know, prophecy, tongues, interpretation of tongues. For me, leads the way for everything I'm going to pray in the Spirit, but that I will also understand with my mind. So I'm going to pray in the Spirit those things which are praying directly to God that no man can understand unless they be interpreted. And out of that praying in the Spirit, I'm also going to pray in the Spirit these things that the Holy Spirit gives me understanding of. This is how God used to give me at the beginning, at the very beginning of growing in these things in the Holy Ghost, how I would receive every one of my sermons. I'd be on prayer before the meeting, and I'd begin to cry out to God and talk to Father and build myself up in my most holy faith, praying in the Holy Ghost. As I'm praying in the Bada Seferidea, and then out of that would begin to come prayer. I begin to pray that which my mind could understand. And out of that prayer, there would be phrases of verses of Scripture. And I would write down the words, those phrases, and then I'd have a Strong's Exhaustive Concordance, because that's all there was at that time. There wasn't computers at that time. And I would take that phrase, that word that I would hear in that sentence that was coming right out of my belly, and I'd go look up all those words, and then a verse of Scripture would stand out to me. And, oh, yeah, that's the one I was just quoting right there. That's it. That's the one the Lord just gave me, and I'd write it down. And this is how also I learned how I began to become that much more familiar with Scripture. I memorized Scripture that much more because of that kind of application. It became more of a part of me. Really, I didn't memorize it. It became a part of me by that act of revelation that was taking place in my life, the interpretation of tongues. And so, you know, the Lord builds on that. This is a present here. You can have that. Now, you want to give yourself to this every day. It's going to be an amazing, wonderful day when God's people, everyone, take responsibility for the meeting. And it's not just the pastor or the preacher that's pressing in the realms of the anointing to be that in that place where God the Holy Ghost can freely flow through us. Huh? If the preacher didn't come, he wasn't pressing in prayer and the word and reaching to God for the things that he wants to say and do through him, saying, Lord, I don't want none of me, all of you. What would the meeting be? It'd be a flop. It'd be just nothing but human. And people, they're going to sit in the chair and they're going to say, just nothing but human. Just there's no anointing. They're going to have all their criticism. But why don't I just turn the tables? Ain't nothing but human. Ain't nothing but, come on. You know, why don't I just turn the tables on everybody, right? And just start talking about the people sitting in the pews, because it's about time somebody starts talking about the people sitting in the pews instead of the people sitting in the pews talking about who's standing in the pulpit. I'm going to put on you what you put, what judgment you judge you should be judged with. Hello. And besides that, the responsibilities are already on you to be functioning as members in the body of Christ, being yielded and submitted and prepared, ready to move and flow and function as a member in the body of Christ. Having that place and that disposition of being able to receive the Word of God. You know, I believe this with all of my heart. I believe that the early church always started with what you read in Acts chapter 2, verse 4. That's how the meeting began. Everybody got baptized in the Holy Ghost. When you look in revivals, take Azusa Street Revival. Ask them how they prayed back in there. Go read what Bartleman said and other live witnesses said. They said the prayer would start, but isn't like prayer you have today. They'd say it like this. I heard this dear woman say this today. They'd start the meetings with prayer, but isn't like it is today. He said the prayer went on minimum for about 30 minutes, and it was a roar in the place. And you didn't know whether it was tongues or what it was. It was a roar. And it was a sound of heaven. And then out of that, sometimes it went much longer. And out of that come forth a burst of singing. And now that would come someone anointed with the word of heaven that always was taking it to another level. And then somebody got up to tell their little testimony or their little whatever, Pop Seymour would stand up and say, no flesh can glory here. Come on. Come on, they'd sit down. That meant sit down. No flesh can glory here. Come on. I mean, people say, I would like to be in that. Oh, really? You would come under that kind of authority? You talk about control. No, that's just Satan's lie against the truth. It's God's government. Praise God. I'll take his control any day. Control me, Holy Ghost. Hallelujah. Habakkuk. Oh, if we do that, we're going to be led to be drinking some Kool-Aid with strychnine in it. That's fear and torment and lies and sedition, huh? Satan's going to always emphasize the evil, the wrongdoing of the person and the people and the group that, you know, was demonized. And that which God did, and the real thing is going to be shining like a light. But I'm telling you right now, we're going to shine with it, okay, in Jesus' name. And then the Lord goes on to say that in the same chapter, he says this is what he's put in the church. It's very important to grab a hold of. And this is available right now. It's in the church. Are you in the church? Is this the church? Everybody says, yes, amen, praise God. And everyone nods knowingly. But the reality of it is, then why is it? Why don't we just come to terms with it? Why don't we get desperate and come to terms with it and say, wait a minute, this is here, this is present, this is a living reality. What's blocking the flow? Instead of acting like God isn't doing what he said he's going to do. We always blame the wrong person here. It's like, oh God, why have you withheld? Why are the heavens brass? All this other thing. That's nonsense. It's because there's hindrances going on in our own lives, things that we are allowing that God is not going to interface with or mix with. I heard one person testify and said, yeah, and any time anybody stood up and in those meetings, it didn't matter, preacher, saint, who they were, and they began to talk out of anything that wasn't clearly the anointing of the Holy Ghost, they come under such intense conviction to shut up. Huh? It has no place here. You have to go down to the church down the street to do that. It don't work here. It ain't about your testimony anymore and giving witness anymore, which was so encouraged and so developed in the holiness movement in the late 1800s. But all it was just man. It didn't result in the move of God. Why can't we stop doing stuff that don't result in the move of God? Why not? Why are we so dull of hearing? Why can't we just look and say, wait a minute. This is natural. This is what God has given. He's faithful. He's doing it right now. I don't have it. It's not God's fault. I'm allowing something in my life that's not supposed to be there. Lord, search me, oh God. And get real with it. And stay right there. And I'm going to tell you right now, as true as God is God and he's a living God, you will know. Unless maybe he likes everyone but you. Maybe the gospel is for everybody except for you. You left out. And of course, if you're going to believe that, that would be the greatest deception, because it's for everyone equally. And yet people do. Many times they'll listen to the lies of Satan, where that lie of Satan makes these things applicable to everybody but you. Now, it's about time we just grab a hold of the things of God and recognize that there's a shield of faith and a sword of the Spirit. A shield of faith will quench every fiery dart of the wicked one, and a sword to take off every giant's head. It will deal the final death blow to every demon spirit harassing your mind. It's about time you rise up in these things. Amen. And it's the sword of the Spirit too. Hallelujah. It's something that you have because you're flowing in the Holy Ghost, which is the Word of God. If I come under the authority of the Word of God, to live under the authority of the Word of God, the way God designed it, to believe it, to agree with it, that it's now, to own it. Now I own it. I'm not waiting for a future day. I own it. It's mine. Future day is never going to come. That's doubt and unbelief. It's mine right now. It's present. He's here. People, I'm going to tell you right now, you begin to live this, talk like this, agree with God, things will change. I don't want to go anywhere in the world and just bring them more Western religion. It's about time just bring them more status quo. It's about, you don't need to go till you baptize in the Holy Ghost. You bust them loose with the power of the living God. We can't hold you back anymore. Hallelujah. Anybody I see busting loose with the Holy Ghost and they say, listen, I'm going to go do this or do that, I'm going, go, run, whatever I can do to help. And the rest I'm going, oh, Father, please, in Jesus' name, make this happen quickly. And how's it going to take place? By the hearing, by the word, hammer's going to come after you. Well, I didn't know I'd go to church over there because there's a hammer. It's a hammer for you because you need a hammer because you're a rock. Yes. You know what I'm saying? Yes. I don't want to go there because it's a fire. It's like a flame, you know, flamethrower every time in the meeting. Yes, because you need it, because you got too much chaff in your life, needs to be burned up. You need to be turning that thing around saying, I love being over there. It's like a flame thrower in the Holy Ghost. Every bit of chaff in my life's getting eradicated. I love going over there. I was hard. Now I'm getting busted up by the Holy Ghost. Amen. Hallelujah. I was hard and resistant. Now I'm been broken before His presence, and I'm yielded and just softest. It's clay in the potter's hand. He can shape me and form me, because He knows how to. Me in just such a way to where I can receive, hallelujah, everything the Holy Ghost is supplying. And God placed it in His church, and it's here right now. This is His church. Yeah. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Father, for it. He put there in His church apostles first, secondarily prophets, thirdly teachers, after that miracles, gifts of healing, helps, governments, diversity of tongues. Wow. Isn't that beautiful? And then there's goes on in 1 Corinthians chapter 14, just laying once again a little bit more foundation, just saying, this is natural. This is what's here. It's what's present. It's now. God said, and it was so. It's just that simple. It doesn't get any harder than that. When you read the events of creation, it doesn't get any harder than that. Vayomer Elohim, and God said. Vayahi kin, and it was so. Everything that God said in His word about you. That's it. Anyway, so. Hallelujah. Oh, Lord, I need you to come into vision. And I need to show you, I need you to show me that you died on the cross for my sins. I need to see in a vision. I need to see some kind of evidence and proof right now that you actually come out of that tomb and raised up from the dead. And then I can't stop there. Then I've got to see that you went on and you were accepted to the Father, and that you sat down at His right hand of the Father, and that you're there right now. And then if I can touch it, and if I can see it a little bit more, then I think I can start believing. And nothing's going to happen. Nothing's going to happen. You probably are not going to get that. But what you are going to get is you're going to get the unseen moving of the Holy Ghost who's going to tug on your heart. And you are going to get God's faithfulness because He's watched over His word to keep it so that you can read it. And it's not just ink on paper. It's living in His power. And if you just open up your heart, just a little teeny tiny crack to God, floodgate will come busting in. Amen. And heaven will fill your soul, and you will know. Hallelujah. You will have this witness. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. And in 1 Corinthians chapter 14, we read, and how is it, brethren? How is it? This is normal. Look at this. Don't tell me it's normal. Quit acting like it's normal. This is normal. How is it then, brethren, verse 26, that when you come together, every one of you has a prophetic song. That's the heavenly anthem. That's that song that comes down by the Spirit. Hallelujah. You know, I heard one report say, you know, it was commonplace for there to be the continual flow of the songs and the Spirit when the rich movings of God was taking place on Azusa Street in those first 3 years. It said by 1916, it's rarely heard anymore. There's too much division over it. I'm never going to stop singing the Spirit. I don't care what the popular opinion is. I'm going with the opinion of heaven. I'm going with what God said. I'm going with His model. He's the same yesterday, today, and forever. He's always going to be doing things just like He did before. And I want a whole lot more. Come on. You need to stir these things up. What happened? You need to have your own personal encounter with Jesus Christ. So that you recognize that where it's not just, this is what the pastor says, this is what the preacher says. It's got to become something that is a living reality to you. And as soon as it does, everything changes. And God's here to give this to you as a living reality. And every time we have a meeting, He shows up. He's here. Hallelujah. The burning bush is here. His burning bush ministry is right here. Hallelujah. Fire God's here. Hallelujah. Presence of the Holy Ghost is here. Baptism of the Holy Ghost and fire is here. You're just going to have to step out of the way. You're going to have to remove yourself from the equation. Jesus is going to have to become bigger to you than all the other things that you have interest in. You have to understand that until you lay down your life down, Jesus is never going to be revealed. And that's even under the point of death. And God's defining laying our life down in the context of being willing to die. That's what it means to be a witness. It is the complete and absent surrender of all that we are now to live in the life of Jesus Christ that is displayed by the unlimited power of the Holy Ghost moving, functioning in our life. And that's what I got. Amen. Amen. And I'm not having anything less, and I'm desperate for more. And so let me hear what you got to say, kind of thing, you know. In fact, brother, let me see. And this is it. This is commonplace. And so I say these things to you not to condemn you, but just say, wait a minute, you need to get passionate about it, because nothing's going to happen until there's spiritual hunger. Spiritual hunger is a law of God. You obey God, and you are going to get His results as much as this Bible will fall to that ground right there because of gravity. It's a law. Don't tell me you obey God and to get His results. You don't obey God. I've heard people say, oh, well, I tried out Christianity and worked for me. You didn't try nothing out. You didn't have the real thing. And I can go and show you where you didn't have the real thing. I can show you where you didn't obey as much as you think you obeyed. Because I'm going to tell you right now, you're a liar. God's true. Amen. And you need to be convinced that you're a liar. Yeah. Yeah. Huh? Yeah. Anything that I would disagree with God about is where I'm a liar. That's where I'm a liar. That's where I'm deceived. What God said is true. Let God be true. And every man a liar, including yourself. Amen. Hallelujah. He's true. He's faithful. He's true. He's trustworthy. And the biggest dimension of us moving in all the miracle provision of God is that we come into a relationship with Him where we trust Him. It's where Adam failed. It's where Adam failed. Say it again. It's where Adam failed. Adam was willing to trust God with total abandonment. He was willing to question God. One word question. Are you sure that He's got your best interest in mind? I'm not sure that He's got your best interest in mind. Because I'm going to tell you something. I got the inside story. I was in the back room. I heard. God knows that in the day that you eat of it, you're going to be like Him, and He doesn't want to give that up. He's controlling. He wants to have certain dimensions of authority and power that you can't have, so that He can always control you and use it against you and hold it over your head. That's what He said. For the Lord does know in the day that you eat, you should be like Him, knowing good and evil. The accusation of hell. the intercessions of hell go on today. I can take you through the Bible at Genesis, beginning there, and show you the intercessions of hell. And reality, when we get done, you're going to go, that's very familiar. Yeah, the voice of Satan has never changed either. He's still doing and saying the same damnable lies he's always been saying. Now you hear people say, oh, those preachers, they controlling over there. It's the voice of hell. It's the voice of Satan. It's demonic. I don't care who says it. I don't care if it's a preacher anointed from the pulpit. He said, oh, yeah, the people in the church, they're controlling. Pastors in the church, they're controlling. The control freaks. Devil. Liar. Right from hell. Lucifer. That's his word. I never heard God say it. Not one time did I ever hear God say that about his people. Not Saul, not nobody. Are you listening to me? Come on, people. We get a whole lot of discernment among all the rest. Well, I wanted to finish that list. When we just believe the Word of God. I tell people all the time, you need to be continually reading the Word of God, because I believe that is how the Holy Spirit shapes us, corrects us, gives us insight. And if you're just reading, oh, I'm just going to spend the next year reading the Proverbs. Well, I hope you get some wisdom out of that. But you know what? You're not getting the whole counsel of God. You know, you need to be continually reading through the whole counsel of God, because then the Lord uses that to correct us, to convince us, to instruct us, to guide us, to establish us, to give us insight. Somebody said, I want revelation. Well, get into the Word of God. You'll get some revelation, man. Find a place of standing in His presence. I'm going to tell you right now, if I want to hear a word from the Lord, all I have to do is go stand in His presence and begin to interact with Him. How do I interact with Him? I learned from great models like Daniel. I begin to worship Him and praise Him and thank Him for all the things that He's doing, all that He's done and all that He's doing right now. I begin to magnify Him and glorify Him and begin, to be caught away. Hallelujah. It's just stuff like, Lord, I can't believe You saved me, washed me with Your own blood, wrote my name in the Lamb's Book of Life, that You keep me by Your power. You're an amazing God, that Your mercy goes as it does. I mean, you just get lost in that. Because it creates a greater passion, a greater hunger out of that. You begin to see Him, and you begin to have a personal relationship on the level where you want to please Him. And you know He's not mad at you. You want to please Him. You know, and then you want to be special to Him. And you know what the context of that is. Huh? And oh, what holiness. Oh, what straight living. What strength of will. It works within our life. You got to find a place to stand before His presence. It's got to quit being boring. It's got to quit being another task that you got to get through after you're done wearing yourself out, working for yourself all day. Are you listening to me? I loved it. I got to hit on that, man. I got to hit on it hard, because it's one of Satan's strategies in modern days that has kept the move of God from going forth. Where would have you work today? Where can you find people that are tarrying before the presence of God for a move of God? For 3 years, 7 days a week, 3 meetings a day. I mean, you got to have some super exciting thing going on. We're just talking about people coming into prayer, crying out to God, saying, we want what You have. We want today, here in our lives right now, what we read about in the Bible, because we recognize that this is reality, and we're not living in reality. We're living in altered reality. We're not living under the mantle and under the glory of what You've declared is our life. And we want the floodlight of heaven to shine upon our soul. We want to be straightened out. Oh, come on, man. Just to have that happen in each individual's life. I believe that that's what Father is looking for today more than ever, because that is going to create a greater explosion of the glory of God. And I believe with all of my heart that it can ultimately has the possibility then of resulting in a longer lived move of God. Because if you look through history, most of the moves of God are like 3 years. I mean, some of the great moves of God, I mean, if you pushed it, it lasted 4 or 5 years, and then it just dwindled, and it just became something that people either lined up with in a denomination or certain expressions that they continued on emphasizing. God's got a whole lot more to emphasize here. Why am I going to emphasize one thing? A brother said to me, he said, I don't want to just emphasize one gift. I want to emphasize every gift. I said, yeah, absolutely. I agree with you. I don't just want to emphasize joy. I want to emphasize some love here and some humility as well. Uh-oh. Blessed silence. Okay? Because I can see a lot of places where people emphasize in joy and they're just as arrogant as you possibly can imagine. They're arrogant. Just arrogance. Where is the humility? Where's the brokenness before the Lord? The Spirit of the Lord has got as much of the characteristic of joy in the presence of the Lord. The Spirit of the Lord and the nature of Jesus Christ is brokenness and humility. It's just that way. And there's not going to be a display of arrogance. There's not going to be covenant breaking. And look, so we, you know, what happens is we get stuck in expressions. We got to watch out. We just make one expression it. And if I'm feeling overwhelmed with joy unspeakable and full of glory, I'm flowing in the Holy Ghost. Well, what if you're feeling overwhelmed with humility and lowliness? What's that? Flowing in something less? How about having every dimension of the glory of God? How about just being overwhelmed with thanksgiving and praise and adoration? I'm telling you, sometimes I'm most overwhelmed with thanksgiving. I just get broken. I just begin to weep at His goodness. Come on. As much as living in joy unspeakable, I want to live in goodness all day long. This is the will of God concerning you in Christ Jesus, that in all things you give thanks. So if that's the will of God, somebody said, I just want to understand what the will of God is for me. I said, man, just name it. Just name it. Listen, take any dimension of Jesus Christ's life, decide what you want to be, and that's the will of God. And if you want the whole thing, that's what God wants for you as well. Just start proclaiming what you're going to do, because Father's going to breathe on it, because He's already said, go into all the world and preach the gospel. All authority is given to me, now go. He said, here it is. Be baptized in the Holy Ghost, receive power from on high, and be my witnesses. Now just write whatever you want to write in that. Amen. Write your 30-year plan, 40-year plan. Get after it. Come on, let's go do something here. Yeah. Everybody's sitting around wondering what the will of God is for their life. Those people are stuck forever. Right. He's already described it. He's displayed it. He showed it. Yes. Get up, do something, whatever you do. God will bless it. That's what He said. Whatever you do, I'll bless it. Whatever you do will prosper. That's what He said. Isn't that beautiful? It's just being freed up here. Amen. Even giving us a spirit of fear. So many people live in the spirit of fear. It's bondage. It's being bound. It's being imprisoned. And fear is a terrible thing. It has torment. It keeps you from the love of God, knowing the love of God and flowing in the love of God. Bust that thing. And if fear came at me, I'd get it. I'd start pounding something, smashing something. In the spirit, though, in the spirit, because I found something far more effective. I got really good at throwing my hands and my feet at one time in my life and moving my body in some really, you know, acrobatic ways to get things done in that realm. I found another way to do it far more effectively in this realm of the spirit. There's passion in the Holy Ghost. Hallelujah. 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 Mandalane. And I get more ferocious and I get more intense about it than anything else in my life. Hallelujah. Amen. Let me finish reading this. And I want you to. I want you to follow me. I'm following Jesus. You have a responsibility to follow me. God said so. Amen. And I don't want you to follow me because I need some kind of ego boost. I want you to follow me because it's God's ordained way of doing stuff. Amen. Hallelujah. And we're not, anything that we do, we're not doing of ourselves, because we don't have any sufficiency of ourselves. For our sufficiency is of God. And what we're doing by the Holy Ghost. And if it ain't by the Holy Ghost, then, you know, come on. It would be evident. But it is evident that it is by the Holy Spirit. Hallelujah. Because God grants us proof of our ministry with signs. He does. And with wonders and gifts of healing and gifts of the Holy Ghost. He does. Hallelujah. And it's a blessing. Amen. And we want that for every one of you. Praise God. So, how is it that every one of you has a psalm? How is it when you come together, brethren, every one of you has a psalm? Every one of you has a doctrine. Remember, doctrines. Paul said, if I come to you speaking in tongues, what should it profit you unless I come by knowledge, by revelation, by prophecy, or by doctrine? Doctrines are the teaching of the Holy Ghost, not what you learn by just, you know, putting all your verses of Scripture together. It is a teachings, the teachings of the Holy Ghost, who is wonderful gifting to function under. I love functioning under that gifting. But here we go, and you should function under that gifting too, because it's available. It's just that, how is it that every preacher that's called of God, every apostle, prophet, evangelist, pastor, and teachers, has a psalm, has a doctrine? This is every one of you concerning the church. Every one of you hath the tongue. Every one of you hath a revelation. See, and that what it does is it takes the meeting to another level and to another level. As the body of Christ begins to function, we don't just, you know, it's like coming to the meeting and all you see is this. It's wonderful. when the whole body starts standing up, moving around, and then every dimension of that which a being is gets to function. It's far more in that than ministry by the hand only. Jesus, help us. As in every one of you had a revelation, an interpretation. Hallelujah. Let everything be done to edifying. It's literally, what does that mean? Let everything be done to the taking it to another level, to the building of the atmosphere of this Holy Ghost crescendo that burst into a whole nother dimension of interacting with God, of being in His presence. You can tell as soon as somebody grabs the microphone and it's going in another direction, you can feel it. I have a confidence. I know how to flow in the anointing. I want to show you, teach you how to flow in the Holy Ghost with everything that God has shown me, so that you can also have a confidence that when you take a hold of the microphone, you know it's going to another level. Why? Because not because you have some special anointing, it's because you have the anointing to function as a member in the body of Christ that is something so natural as breathing for you and me. It's what's present. And we're not having any stuff like fear and all the rest of the mess in there, in here, blocking and hindering and stopping that which God would do. We're passionate about this. We got to have what God demands. Amen. 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 Well, praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. In Jesus' name. Live under the mantle of His love. Live under the power and the glory of His fire and of His presence. Let God take your hold of your life. And now begin to live all those things that He described. In Jesus' name. And then namasateya nipahaya. Halalada basuti. Ha ha. Nubandarefe. If you've been baptized in the Holy Ghost with the evidence of speaking of tongues resident within your life and available to you by virtue of the fact that the person of the Holy Ghost has right and free course within your life without limits is every gifting of the Spirit. But it must be yielded to, that those things may be strengthened and developed and matured in your life. Hallelujah. Ha ha. Hallelujah. Ha ha. And then just walk around and praise Him. Walk around and give thanks to Him. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. My mama. Satan would come and try to point out all the people that didn't get healed. God, the Holy Ghost, would come and point out the people that did get healed. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. And the discernment of what God is doing, what the powers of darkness are doing, is very easy to grab a hold of. And we pray in the name of Jesus that you have such discernment and that you'll not listen to the lies of the enemy that try to discourage you anymore, try to beat you down. But you'll be bold in the faith. You won't lay down to nothing. You won't submit yourself to nothing. Hallelujah. But you rise up and you press in. You break through the thing. You won't be stopped in Jesus' name. Thank you, Jesus. Mingasateya manaliya pasuda. Nembambrabasasaya tiyashibakura namatideya. Masotiriyantarabasiyakiyasha. Maranda de dea, the Yasiran Makataya, she a paha. Maranda de Shikia de la Bahala, the Yatarabasi. Maranda de Satian de la Bahala, the Yaka. Herbre de dea, she a tala. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Father, for this wonderful flow that's beginning to take place in David's life. Father, we thank you for an explosive move of the Spirit. Ha ha ha. Meze zutaya. Meze zutusia teninishi. Angalea de zuraya. Maranda de. I want to say this and last thing in saying this. When Satan comes and tells you you don't deserve anything, you don't have the right to lift your head up before the presence of God, listen. You didn't never deserve anything. And you never had any right to lift your head up in the presence of God. And you're far better off right now than when Christ Jesus first found you. You're far better off when the Holy Ghost first found you. And if you were good enough for Him when He first found you to redeem you and save you, how much better are you now? Huh? And having begun in the Spirit, He's going to take care of you. Hallelujah. And the blood of Jesus that cleansed you when you were so foul and filthy then, how much more is the blood of Jesus Christ going to cleanse you if you should trip up and fall in any sin right now? Just tell the devil he's a liar and get out of here because you're not talking to him no more. Turn and start talking to the Holy Ghost and take it, Jesus. It's a free gift. I got a gift. I got a gift that came from me from God. He who began a good work in me is going to complete that work. I don't got to worry about nothing. But just to cooperate with them and participate. It's like I said, people say, I just feel like giving up. I just ought to give up. The only person who should feel like giving up is God. He's not. And you give up, what are you going to do then? Come on, don't let Satan lie to you no more. He's stupid. He tells stupid lies. Don't listen to him anymore. He's a liar that you can detect instantly. He's pathological in this lie. Just because he believes it, don't believe it. Believe what God says. Believe the truth. The truth shall liberate you. You believe a lie, you'll be damned. You'll be put into prison. It holds you in bondage. Don't believe a lie. Get intense about it. Get intense about it. A lot of times I've found myself rebuking people so that I could break the thing off so that they would in turn get intense. And I've watched it over and again. They'll either get hurt and be upset and walk away. Hurt and upset. Mad, hurt and upset. Huh? Or they'll get a breakthrough. They go, you're right. I've had so many people say, man, right after you brought that down so strong on me and it hurt so deep, it's like something broke. It's like I've got this newfound boldness. Yeah, that's the way it works. Hey, praise God. Look at here. This is a life and death matter. You might not understand it. It's a life and death matter. Huh. It's a difference of whether Jesus is going to be revealed in your life or Satan's going to be able to harass you to the point of you giving up. I'm telling you, we're here to be helpers of your faith, to encourage you, to bust up off of you, to say you can't live like that, you can't think like that, you can't be like that in Jesus' name. Amen. Praise God for parents that told us that when we were misbehaving, playing in the street, eating worms or whatever it was. Jesus. Thank you, God, for parents. Thank you for correction. Thank you for those who've come. Thank you, Holy Spirit, you've come and lead us and guide us in the truth to show us what's right and what's wrong. Thank you, Lord, that you have anointed men and women with your mantle to be able to do that. And listen, that's such a wonderful thing. And then we have to begin to, God's people need to value these things in God. They just want to, as though the Holy Spirit's going to come and manifest and show them everything. Well, He is. He is. And he's going to cause you to hook up with that realm so that He may fully be able to do that through this wonderful, glorious thing that God ordained and that God created through the blood of Jesus Christ. When He purchased His church with His own blood, His blood was used to create something. This glorious church that we get to be a part of, that He then filled with life. It wasn't just a body laying there, formed and fashioned in all the beauty and splendor of God's divine glory. He came now and He baptized it with the Holy Ghost and fire, breathing into it the Spirit of life, the breath of life. Hallelujah. So we as the church living by the Holy Ghost, this very life of Jesus Christ. And from this day forward, in the name of Jesus, just say, you can't live without it. You're not going to be without it. And just worship God and thank Him for all that He's done and know that He'll complete it. He'll finish it. And as long as you're desperate about the maturing, about being used by God, this one thing is for certain. You will. Amen. Amen. Hallelujah. Harabasi tikiya. Halavita. Hallelujah. Don't want to stop, you know. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Everybody just lift your hands towards heaven. Now, in Jesus' name, if you're watching by the web right now, you're here in this place, if you have any sickness and disease in your body, out! It goes out. I command it, go! In Jesus' name. You have fear and torment. Listen, fear and torment is a terrible thing. It will grab a hold of you. It's a claw that will hold on to you. And there's going to be some serious reaction in your life to see that thing broken. So I want you to react with that kind of seriousness with it. But in the name of Jesus, you foul spirit of fear and torment, I command you to lead the people of God. Holy Spirit, we thank you that you are the comforter, that you've come to encourage us, that we can always rely upon you, that, Lord, we're not going to fail where Adam failed in a trust relationship, but we're going to succeed like Abraham did, and just trusting you and going all the way with you. We're going to succeed in this ministry in Christ Jesus, in person in Christ Jesus, to do all your will, Father. We thank you so much. Thank you for the anointing right now. I thank you for the strength. I thank you for the anointing. Hallelujah. I thank you for the anointing. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you. Amen. We'll love all of you. We won't have a school of spirit for a while. We're going to do it in Zambia. Go do it in Zambia for a couple of weeks. Probably right now will be the first, you know, if the Lord tarries his coming. And I don't want him to do that. Somebody said, well, how about all the loss? Well, look, listen. Yeah, I am concerned for the lost. But I'm so desperate to be with him. So if the Lord doesn't tarry his coming, and we return from Africa by his goodness and mercy, then on Friday, the first week of June, we'll do another School of the Spirit. Amen. Love you. Find a bunch of people. Hug them. Tell them that you love them. Somebody said, how can I grow in love? By practicing love. By participating with love. How can I grow in joy? By just participating with being happy. Being joy. Then one of the best ways to do that is thanksgiving and praise. Somebody says, how can I participate? How can I grow in the gifts of healing? Pray for more people. Start with yourself. Amen. And don't lay down to sickness. I'm going to say this. Don't lay down to sickness. Don't lay down to sickness. Maybe if you get sick, maybe you need to back up and let God show you that you're not eating properly, you're not resting properly. Some people got way too much sugar in their diets. And I can go on with it. I can go on with the list. And especially as women get older, it's going to mess with your body more. I just tell you, it's just it is. And I mean, some of these things the Lord showed me by the Spirit, some of the things he showed me just academically, but we just adjust anything we need to adjust in our eating habits and our resting, whatever. Maybe we're allowing stress in our life. We don't understand how to deal with that. Make those adjustments, but then you get up and you move in great confidence of your complete and total healing, and anything gets in your way, you smash it. And I mean, you smash it, and you deal with it that way. You smack it, okay? And you deal with it that way, with that kind of intensity. You don't just say, no, you ravenous rabid wolf, foaming at the mouth wolf that wants to devour me and kill me and destroy me. I tell you, you have to leave. You can't be around here. And nobody can do that. You're going to get violent with it. Deal violent with it. And somebody can say, well, I don't believe you have to do that. Well, would you please model that for me? Model that for me. Model where you don't have to do it, because for right now, all that I've ever seen and all that I know firsthand that is effective in God is where you get up and you smash it and you determine it ain't going to be, this ain't running over me. You sick and tired of being sick and tired. You've had enough. It's that kind of, I've had it up to here now. I'm not taking it anymore. It ain't got to be this way anymore. It's a determinate will. It's a determinate will. Hallelujah. Things will happen because God has willed it. And what happens when you get strong about your will? I heard a wealthy man, a very wealthy man, accomplished a lot of things. Somebody said, how is it that you do all these things? He says, because I've willed it. Not doesn't know the Lord. I willed it. Just as mean and as honorary as it can be, he willed it. What happens if God's people get up off their blessed assurance and start willing it that with that kind of passion? I want you to get that. I want you to get passion. I want you to get fighting mad in Jesus' name. I want you to get mad. I want you to get fighting mad in Jesus' name. Truly. That's right. Because that's the way the Lord. It's a battle. It's a war. Therefore, be strong in the strength of the Lord and power of his might, and execute his righteous judgments over your life, over your family, over your things. Amen? Yes. Amen. And over everybody around you that you can influence. Amen. Amen.